morning. Let's pray. Almighty God, merciful Father, your faithfulness continues through all generations. You establish the earth and it endures. Thank you that we can be here today to worship you, to learn more about you and about how we can respond better to the love and kindness you first showed us. Thank you for your patience with us. You are an amazing, creative God. We see images of your creation in the far corners of the universe, and we are stunned by its vastness and beauty. We can hardly comprehend the scale of these things, millions, even billions of light years away. We are so insignificant in the whole scheme of things, yet you care about every detail of our lives, our struggles, our families, our friends. Thank you for your inspired and totally reliable word, which shows us how we can live our best life, how we can honor you with the time, resources, and opportunities you give us. As the psalmist wrote, even perfection has a limit, but your commands are boundless. I pray that we, like Jeremiah, can feel your word burning in our hearts like fire, more tiring to keep it to ourselves than to share it with others. Thank you for the community of believers that we can be a part of. Thank you for the support we can give each other as we do life together. Thank you for the tremendous examples in our midst of no excuse followers of your Son Jesus, in whose mighty name we pray. Thank you for giving us hope and a future, for giving us the opportunity to live life to the full, rather than be dragged along by the desire for all things worldly and temporary. Help us to see beyond the here and now, not just a wishful thinking of an eternal paradise, but a deep confidence, a yearning to be with you forever. Thank you for the children in our congregation. Help us to set a great example to them as we model a lifestyle of faith and obedience to you. Thank you for those of us who are older. Help us all to never grow weary of doing what is good and right. We ask that anyone with health challenges may feel the comfort that only you can provide. Your word says that your eyes range throughout the earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to you. Thank you. We pray for the war in Ukraine to stop. Help us to check ourselves whenever we feel like grumbling about life in the UK, and instead choose contentment and gratitude for the abundance and security we enjoy. Amen.
Our Father in heaven, you are a God of miracles. You are so creative. The surface of the earth is made up of such varied landscapes and oceans, and the whole world is teeming with life in its many forms. Human beings are each made in your image. Every one of us has the capacity to do immense good, if only we choose to break free from the mould of the world. Please help each one of us here to live our lives in a way that will impact those around us, to be a beacon of light in a dark world. We know many people dread confrontation or loneliness at Christmas time. Help us to be a comfort to those who face stress or hardship this winter, to be peacemakers, and to proclaim the truth of Jesus' gift of salvation to mankind. Thank you for the gift of wisdom, to be able to see situations from your standpoint and to get things in a proper perspective. Please bless us with the courage to accept our humble status before you and rejoice in our special relationship with you. Help us to overcome all sins against us and to forgive and to move on. Thank you for today's communion and sermon. Let them call us together and arm us against the distractions that we face in our daily lives. Please soften our hearts to accept the power of your word and bless us with miracles, victories, and trials, all to bring glory to yourself. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Right, let's all stand as we worship. Mighty to save. compassion, the love that never faileth, that mercy follows me, and everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, all the of salvation. He comes and conquers the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me. All my fears and failures, fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior, He can do the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can do the mountains. My God is mighty to save, He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine a light and the whole world sing. We sing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine the light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine the light and let the whole world sing. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine the light and let the whole world sing. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can rule the mountains. Mighty to save, He is mighty to save. Savior, author of salvation, He conquered the Jesus conquered the grave.
Amen. You are holy. You are mighty. You are worthy. Worthy of praise. I will follow. I will listen. I will love you all of my days. are holy. You are mighty. You are worthy. Worthy of praise. I will honor. I will praise you. I will love you all of my days.
Amen. Let's get seated as we have Yinka and Tiwa for the communion.
Good morning, friends and family. Good morning, friends and family.
Morning.
Good. It's very cold, isn't it? The good news is that it may be a white Christmas. This is the time of the communion. This is where we reflect on the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. My name is Yinka, and my beautiful wife is Tiwa. We'll be reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, from verse 23 to 28. 1 Corinthians 11, 23 to 28. I read. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup." In this scripture, Paul is declaring what Jesus commanded and instructed the disciples on the night he instituted the communion. Jesus, in this scripture, took bread, prayed, and shared it with his disciples. He told them that the bread represents his body that will be sacrificed for them. But one key thing here is that he said, "When you eat, remember." Remember. He did the same for the wine, which he said represents his blood. Why would Jesus require them to eat the bread and wine and drink the wine in order to remember him? Do you ever imagine eating food, your breakfast, and remembering something? But to Jesus, there was a reason. It was important to Jesus that we continue to remember his sacrifice. Jesus knew that when he's not around, we may forget. Jesus also wanted to take the actions of remembrance. He wants us to take the actions of remembrance in a worthy manner. Jesus does not want us to take it lightly. I think a few weeks ago we did the remembrance service. You know, this can be a light thing. You know, you forget about history and we just do it for the doing's sake. But Jesus is not all about just the actions. He wants the heart behind the actions. Jesus said, examine yourself before you eat the bread and drink the wine. By examining ourselves, he wants us to repent of any sin that could make us unfit before we take the bread and wine. Remembering what has been done helps us to remain grateful to Jesus. In so doing, our love for him does not diminish, but increases and drives our actions day by day. Tiwa would now share.
Good morning. So if there were to be a memoir written on mine and Yinka's life, it would probably be titled Remind Me to Remember. So Yinka and I are both just as forgetful as each other. It's quite alarming sometimes. Often I'll say to Yinka, please remind me in 5 minutes to do X, Y, Z. 30% of the time he'll remember. Most times I just resort to asking Alexa to remind me of the things I need to do in an hour or tomorrow. So becoming a new mum this year, I find myself more forgetful than ever, and I'm already someone who has a really terrible short-term memory. So I would set reminders of things that I needed to get done. Some of them were things you'd think I'd remember on my own, like feed Caleb in 2 hours, because I just couldn't keep up with the frequency at which he was feeding, or perhaps get Caleb ready for bed at 7 p.m. And of course, over time, I began to automatically remember these things as I got used to doing them over and over again. I have to confess, I even set calendar reminders for all of my friends' birthdays, because I've forgotten a few birthdays a few times, and honestly, it makes me feel like a terrible friend. The thing is, I'll remember months, weeks, and even days leading up to their birthday, but somehow I end up forgetting on the actual day. In essence, my life is a series of reminders, both great and small, and of high and low priority, many of which I still forget, even though reminders have been set. I'm extremely forgetful, and sometimes this is also apparent in my walk with God, where I can, you know, forget all the marvelous things that he's done in my life over the years and just how powerfully he's worked to bring me to where I am today. So when I catch myself in this state of forgetfulness, I have to actively recount all of God's goodness and, you know, countless times that he's just rescued me from ruin in order that I may actually persevere in faithfulness and trust. By nature, we tend to be forgetful beings, easily remembering and clinging onto bad memories, and yet so easily forgetting all of the good. That is why Jesus calls us to remember his sacrifice for us. When we continuously allow it to be the focus of our lives, we will always have hope of something greater to come.
Thanks, baby. So Jesus wants us to remember. He knows how we are formed. Before we take the bread and drink the wine, we'll pray. But before we pray, let's remember, let's take a reflective moment on all the things that Jesus has done for us. Let's pray. Dear God in heaven, we're so grateful for your sacrifice for us. Thank you for dying for us. Thank you for giving up your body so that we can be free. Thank you, God, for relieving us of our sins. Thank you for giving us opportunity to also remember you. Thank you that you know every details of our life. You know how forgetful we are, and you've instituted things in place so that we can remember you. Please, God, as we take the bread, we pray that you will help us not to take it in an unworthy manner, oh God. We pray that we can reflect on our past weeks, our past day, our past month, and realign ourselves to you, O God. We pray in your son's name, Jesus. Amen. Let us pray before we drink the wine. Dear God in heaven, we commit this wine that represents your blood that was shed on the cross for us. We pray that as we drink this wine, we pray that we will not do it in an unworthy manner, but in a manner worthy of your sacrifice. We pray in your son's name, Jesus. Amen.
We'll sing the song, Lead Me to Calvary.
King of my life, I crown thee now. Thine shall the glory be. Lest I forget thy thorny crown, lead me to Calvary. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget, O Lord, thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary. Show me the tomb where thou wast laid, tenderly mourned and wept. Angels in robes of light arrayed guarded thee while thou slept. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget, O Lord, thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary. Let me, like Mary, with a gift for thee. Show me now the empty tomb. Lead me to Calvary. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget, O Lord, thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary. May I be willing, Lord, to bear daily my cross for thee, even thy cup of grief to share. Thou hast borne all for me, lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget, O Lord, thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary. Fill me, O Lord, with thy desire, for all who know not thee. Then touch my lips with holy fire, to speak of Calvary, lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget, O Lord, thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary, lest I forget, O Lord, thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary.
And now, Rob.
Good morning, everyone. It's a bit cold, isn't it? Okay. Christmas is a time of giving, and we're going to talk a bit about giving now. An opportunity to reflect on how God has given to us and how we, in turn, can give to others. And amidst all the traditions around Christmas, it is important to remember that we're here because of a God who gave. God created a planet, as was talked about in the prayer, on which we live and made it suitable for us. And sent his son into the world by having him born, not in a glorious palace as might befit him, or even a guest room in a house, but in a humble shelter amongst the livestock. And God showed his heart for the poor by sending his angels to announce the birth to shepherds, humble shepherds, staying out in the fields. And yet he also showed his majesty, Jesus' majesty, by sending magi from the east to come and worship him. And as we talked about on Friday, thinking about the Magi, that Jesus' family had to flee persecution and flee Bethlehem to escape from the king. And maybe Jesus' earliest memories were of being a poor refugee in Egypt. And perhaps God, in his providence, sent those Magi from the east with gifts, not only to signify how great Jesus was, but also to provide for the family in their upcoming time of need. Jesus came not to be served, but to serve, and he calls us to do the same. He was a humble king, a suffering savior, who experienced what it was like to be poor. And we're going to talk now, over the next slide, about an offering that we're giving to those in need. And it encourages me, I always think of the scripture that where it says that Jesus said himself, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And over the last few weeks, we've been thinking about the East in terms of India, okay, out in the East. Like the Magi came from the East, we're giving to East, to India. And it encourages me that that the people in poverty, I think of if I was there, if I was to go, I don't know if many of us have been to India. I haven't yet. I'm sure maybe a few of us have. But if you can imagine walking around that kind of community, a slum community where people have migrated in search of a better life, in search of trying to have enough money and maybe to better the life of their family, and you would see people living in a one-room house, in a tin shack like that, you would kind of want to do something, but you wouldn't really know. Maybe you could give them some money to buy some food, but you're not really helping. And it really encourages me to know that our brothers and sisters are there in India providing a school and staffing it and reaching out into the community and helping children not only just to give them something for the day or a week, but to provide them with a real quality education and in the whole aspect of their life. And it encourages me that, yes, the Magi went and they had to search for Jesus, and to think that our brothers and sisters going out there searching for people in need and helping them to change and to have the prospect of growing and having a transformed life. I'm glad that we therefore have this opportunity. And at Christmas time, that we don't need to just be seduced by adverts telling us to buy things that we don't really need, but we can think of, rather than spending money on stuff, that we can actually give and sacrifice what for us might be luxuries or even cut back on some necessities, and so that we can give to others who are in need. And as I say, it's education, because education, in the words of Nelson Mandela, is the most powerful weapon with which you can use to change the world. And it encourages me that the school isn't just about net education in the narrow sense, but also in the wider sense, about their place in the world, about living a full, healthy life and being a blessing to their communities. We showed a video from the school on Friday, and it was wonderful seeing the happy children in their school uniforms, and you get a sense of the pride and the gratitude they feel for the education they are receiving. And they will never meet us, or maybe a few of us, perhaps. So it is a real testimony to our faith and the hearts that we have that we're giving to people that for whom we'll never meet. But it's great that we can see pictures of them and see videos, and I'm looking forward to hearing more stories through the year next year. If you haven't given already, today is the last day for the collection. There are details going to come on the screen now, as if by magic. There we go. We've got this planned. This is great. So if you have already signed a gift aid form, if you haven't, then Andy Frost, who's going to give us a wave, there we go, has even got gift aid forms with him today. And you could sign a gift aid form if you're a taxpayer and then give from your bank account to that bank account. All the details have been sent out in an email as well, or you could take a picture and just put the reference Hyderabad School, because Hope Worldwide support many projects. You want to make sure it goes to the right one. If you're giving less than £100, then you can go to the Hope Worldwide website, decide the amount, and then click down Hyderabad School. And so that is what I wanted to say about the announcement. I will now pray and give thanks and pray for this collection. Father, we thank you for all the ways that you have given to us. Lord, help us in turn to give to others in whatever ways that we can. And we thank you so much for the way you've moved the hearts here to give in all sorts of different ways in our communities this year. We also pray for the Hope School in Hyderabad. Thank you for the teachers and all those others who serve diligently. And we pray for our gift, that it helps and encourages all those who serve and benefit from the school. And we pray that also it unlocks further funding from the community and from local businesses, so that the gift that we give is multiplied and is used to change and transform so many lives. We thank you that we are in this position to give. Thank you for everyone's hearts in giving. And we pray and give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning, everyone. I have a few announcements. I'd like to welcome a family that have traveled all the way over from Australia. They are part of our Melbourne church, and that is Matt, Elaine, and Rachel Beanland. A very warm welcome to you. I know it was too hot in Melbourne, so they've decided to come to the wonderful city of London and enjoy the weather and its sights. Now, after today's service, we have a special event coming up. We have Tony and Yar, who are going to be baptized after today's service. That is going to be very exciting, and a very exciting event. And that will be outside at about 1:45 in the courtyard out there. 12:45, thank you very much. 12:45 in the courtyard out there with warm water, hopefully. After that, there will be a family group leaders meeting. That will be at around 1:15. That will be on the first floor. It's open to all members of the congregation, particularly those who are striving to aspiring to leadership. And we will be just reflecting back on 2022 and the fantastic things that God has done in our church. This Friday, we will be back here at 7:30 for our family night. That is a time to reflect on the recent sermons that we've been hearing, but also a time to have some great game and quiz. So that will be very exciting at 7:30 this Friday. And next Sunday, 11 o'clock, we will be back for our usual Sunday service. Now, in 2 weeks' time, we have our carol service on Sunday morning at 11 o'clock. Let us be inviting our friends to come along to that. It promises to be an exciting time of singing carols. There will be a children's play as well, which has been written by Rachel. So that will be very exciting. We have a YoPro Christmas party coming up on the 17th of December, which is a Saturday. YoPros, you can sign up for that Christmas party on Church Suite. It's only £10 for a great evening out, enjoying yourself. Now, yesterday, the leadership team went away to the sunny part of East Barnet, and my wife is going to share some of the highlights that we talked about.
Hello, everyone. Yeah, we had an amazing leadership team away day. And one thing that we thought there was that we're so grateful for the ministry leaders who look after really everything in the church, from Kids Kingdom to worship to the digital ministries. They do such an excellent, excellent job and take care of the majority of what we do together as a church. And they make our lives as the leadership team so easy. So thank you to all of you. And we're so grateful. And we're also so grateful to everyone for your support and also for your prayers as we put together the plans for the year, because, you know, we really want to do what God wants us to do, and we're so grateful for your prayers. So you will hear really in detail about the plans for 2023 at the meeting on Friday the 16th, but I'll just tell you a few snippets now to whet your appetite. So the theme for the year will be Jesus, the man, the message, and the mission. And we will have sermons on the book of John and the book of Acts. And I'm really excited here that we're going to be meeting twice in the year with the whole London church at Friends House. And yeah, and then this is really exciting. After all the separation we had due to COVID, we've got some ideas for some great things that we can do. We've got some exciting options that we have, such as a weekend away for the whole of the church. Or a day out to Chessington World of Adventures for all of the church, or a barn dance here in the hall at APS with a live band. So we've got various ideas, and we're looking for eager volunteers who will get together to plan one of these or all of these events, who knows. So if you're interested in helping to plan something like that, something really great for the year, then please do make it be known that you'd be interested, and we'll be very grateful. And I think 2023 is going to be a fantastic year. So let's continue to pray and continue just to put our faith in God for all the things he's going to do. Thank you.
Well, we've had a really exciting 2022, and 2023 is going to be even more exciting by God's grace and our faith. That's all the announcements that I have. During the next song, the children will go out to practice for their nativity play. The preteens will be staying in the service today. So let us all stand while we have this song before Charles comes up to preach the message. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to sing Take the Lord With You.
gotta take the Lord with you, children, everywhere you go. You gotta take the Lord with you, children, everywhere you go. You gotta take the Lord with you, children, everywhere you go. On the street, in the home, on the job, all alone. Highway, byway, highway, byway. You gotta make disciples daily, children, everywhere you go. You gotta make disciples daily, children, everywhere you go. You gotta make disciples daily, children, everywhere you go. On the streets, in the home, on the job, all alone. Highways, byways, highways, byways. You gotta love your brothers and sisters, children, everywhere you go. You gotta love your brothers, sisters, children, everywhere you go. You gotta love your brothers, sisters, children, everywhere you go. On the street, in your home, on the job, all alone. Highways, byways, highways, byways, highways, byways. Now, Charles.
Well, it's totally exciting to be together. And yes, it's cold, but this is England, so let's get fired up. And hopefully I make enough noise to keep us warm. Amen. That's right. Let me warm up. But you know, it's been so great just to see what God is doing. Even this weekend, I've been so busy and just hearing and seeing just how God has moved so powerfully in amongst us. On Friday, it was such a great time being part of the congregational service and with the YoPros that organized an amazing service, solemn, just so wonderful. And we had a great chance to just thank and reflect on all the things that we are grateful that God has done over 2022. And yesterday, as you know, the leadership team had their away day, and as Sarah was sharing, it was very, very inspiring to just hear and see all what the ministry leaders are actually planning and putting forward. And our prayer, we want to thank you for praying, and let's continue to pray together that we will see great things happen next year. But today, you know, just as Rob shared, it's our day of love offering, giving the opportunity to give sacrificially to support the education of children who will help their own community, their own family, and we may never see them, but they will be able to see the work of God in their lives. And it's such a privilege that, yes, at Christmas is a time where we celebrate God giving us his son, and then we too, just as the Bible says, you know, just as we have received freely, we should freely give. And I pray that we all can make the sacrifice, because sometimes we look at ourselves and think, wow, you know, we're with all the issues and prices going high and insurance and different payments that we're having to pay. But yet, God has put us in such a privileged position to be able to give to those who are less privileged. And it's only God that will bless all the things that we ever give. So, you know, it's exciting. And today, you know, for the message, we are going to be looking at Hebrews chapter 12 with the title, The Race of Life. How many of us has been in a race before? All right, even as children, I'm sure some of us have tried that. But, you see, when we run, you know, we do all kinds of running. I know growing up, you know, when I was a bit on the younger side, I like to sprint. Sprinting is, you know, because you sprint and you can get to where you want to get to quickly. But I remember I had to pack that one in a few years back. I think on Friday I was reminded by Jabu, seeing Jabu, because it was one of these, we're having a teen event and it was someone's birthday. We got outside and I wanted to show them this energy I have to run. And I was taking on the young teens. I thought, you know, it's like I was going to show them exactly what it's all about. But as soon as it was, funny enough, it's in my neighborhood, so everybody's watching from their windows, and we took off, and they say, oh, your mark, get ready, boom. And I thought I had it. And I was just running so fast, and before you know it, it was Jabu, phew, Matthew Budget, phew. And I was like, no, maybe there was something that happened. The wind was blowing the wrong side. So I said, let's cancel that one. Let's start again. We did it 3 times. In the end, I realized my time for sprint is over. But and since then, I have gone into a different kind of running. Long distance running. And that long distance running, you know, some people run. Some of us do jogging. In my earlier days, I used to, you know, long distance jogging, and I did the marathon, and I did it again. But these days, it looks like it has become that the running, long distance running is out of the place. It's now long distance jogging and shuffling. Some of you can't relate, but I still have the stamina. But, you know, so today we're going to be talking about racing, and, you know, the race of life. The race of life, you know, it's we can look at it as like, wow, life, you know, you hear people say, oh, wow, life is a vicious circle. You know, it's like a little rat race. But really, it depends on what kind of race you are running. And sometimes even as Christians, we, in our mindset, we think, wow, the Christian race is just about sprinting. But yes, we can sprint, but it is a long distance race. And it's about learning how to run in such a way to actually finish. It's not all about starting the race or being part of it. The fact that we are alive, we're already in the race of life. And so we are going to look at today some areas from the book of Hebrews that will help us understand how to run in such a way to be able to finish. And you see, when we run race of life, you know, if some of us run so that we can get some earthly, you know, reward. But if it's just about earthly reward, you see, our life is much more than this earthly existence. We are created for eternity. Every single human being is created for eternity. But the amazing thing is that the short period we have on this earth, we are to use it to determine if it's going to be eternity with life with God or eternity separated from God. God's desire is very plain, but God has given us all the chance to decide what kind of race are we going to run. Are we all together? You see, when we're running the Christian race, it becomes not one of just giving us earthly satisfaction, fulfillment, achievement, and reward. But when we run the Christian race, it's one that fulfills us basically materially in different ways, but also eternally. There's so much reward that is awaiting those of us who stay in it and finish the race. And I will tell you a little bit more about the marathon. But, you know, we're going to be looking at the book of Hebrews chapter 12. And as several of us know, we've been going through the book of Hebrews, and the book of Hebrews, as many of us know, was written around 69 AD to Christians who come from a Jewish background. They started, you know, with running a race in their their religious background and from a Jewish. But then they realized the package that Christ has brought, and they embraced Christ and entered the kingdom of God and began the Christian life race. But then after a while, what has happened is that there's so much trials and hardship they were facing, and then they begin to lose their faith. They become disillusioned, and then some of them are now feeling, maybe we can, it's not quite, wow, we haven't finished yet. You know, they're like, wow, we've gotten the earthly reward, but the, you know, eternal reward is not quite coming the way we want, and so they become disillusioned and wanting to go back to just racing like any other person, no more doing the Christian race, and return back even more so to the Judaism and the law that they have left, just doing ritualistic religion. So this book was therefore written to really basically remind them, you know, as they're struggling their faith, that listen, in Christ, Christ has made the provision, and Jesus is so superior to the religion that they want to follow, that in every way, Christ is better and greater than even all the angels. In fact, the angels were created by Jesus, who is God. And then it talks about that Jesus is greater than even all the whole high priest, all the high priests who mediate between man and God, because they sacrifice bulls and so to just help people connect with God. But Jesus himself gave up his own blood. And he's the only perfect blood that can actually wipe sins away. And then it goes on to talk about that, you know, the rest of Hebrews, that Jesus is not only better than, you know, the angels, not better than, more superior than any high priest, but also Jesus is actually superior to the Moses and the covenant that Moses really brought about, the old covenant. And then he begins to talk about all the benefits that we have in the new covenant. So that's what the background is. And last week, we looked at Hebrews chapter 11, where the writer reminded his audience and all of us about the many ordinary people. People who were just commoners, sinful, with weaknesses like every one of us, but then God used them to do extraordinary things. All because they choose not to run any kind of race, but they wanted to run a life race that is by faith. And we remember, you know, last week as our brother Robert really preached so powerfully about living a life by faith is different from any other thing. So that's what the Hebrews writer dealt with in Hebrews 11. So in Hebrews 11, we're seeing so many of these people doing amazing things. And when you read it, you get so inspired. You say, I want that for my life. But then in Hebrews chapter 12, it begins to let us know that, hey, all these men, they were actually living, but they didn't quite get the reward. The reward is coming with what Christ has to bring. You see, in the aim, basically in Hebrews 12, we learn that Jesus is the author and the perfecter of a life of faith. All these people lived a life of faith here and there and failed, but Jesus is the one who actually perfects a life of faith. So which is again telling us that, wow, you know, we can follow any of the great men of faith in the Bible, but Jesus is so superior and greater because he is the one that perfects faith. He is the one that is the author of the faith that we believe in. And so as we look this morning into Hebrews chapter 12, I want us to really open wide our hearts so that we can see, you know, from Jesus, how do we then live our life in order to really run this race in a way like Jesus has run it so that he actually finished. As he wrote them earlier, reminding them that Jesus has died, not only died, triumphantly been raised, and is seated at the right hand of God, interceding for those of us who have chosen to choose the Christian race of life. Are we all together in that? So we have 2 points today to look at. Number one is run like Jesus did. And number two is stay in the race to the very end. Let's go to God in prayer, and then we open up Hebrews chapter 12. Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, we're so grateful just to be able to gather together. The freedom we have and all that you're doing in our life, help us not to allow the obstacles or the things that are going on around the world to really rob us of the joy of really connecting with you and being able to experience the power of a life that is led by faith. Help us, God, to follow the perfecter of our faith, to run it in a such a way as to harvest all the fruits and the benefits that you want to give us here on this earth. And then why we even look forward to the inheritance when we leave this earth. Thank you for this time. I pray that every one of us, you open our hearts this morning, that we can be able to receive from you exactly what we need in order to run this race of life. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, let's go to Hebrews chapter 12. And we're going to go breeze through it and just touch on the points. From verse 1, it reads, therefore, which tells you, following on from looking at Hebrews 11, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning his shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. In your struggles against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood, and have. You completely forgotten this word of encouragement that addresses you as a father addresses his son. It says, my son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you, because the Lord disciplines the one who he loves, and he chastens everyone he accepts as his son. Endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as his children. For what children are not disciplined by their father? If you are not disciplined and everyone else undergoes discipline, then you are not legitimate, not true sons and daughters at all. Moreover, we have all had human fathers who disciplined us and we respected them for it. How much more should we submit to the Father of the Spirit and live? They disciplined us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplines us for our good in order that we may share in his holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. Therefore, strengthen your feeble arms and weak knees. Make level path for your feet, so that the lame may not be disabled, but rather healed. Isn't that such an encouraging passage? You know, it's just calling us that, yeah, this race of life, we can run it in such a way, like Jesus did, that he finished the race and seated at the right hand of God. He has triumphed. He says, every single one of us, no matter how weak we may feel, no matter how useless we may be feeling by our life situation or life challenges, Christ wants to show us and take us on a journey to really be able to run it in such a way as to be so triumphant. And that's what encourages me so much, because even this year, it's not just that we've done things, come to church, do so many activities, but we've seen so many lives being transformed like never before. Many of us have been discipled for a while, but this year, even in the midst of transferring from lockdown and all this in COVID into just being alive, to see our lives being transformed, it's like Christ has just come. But Christ can come to every one of us when we decide to give him room to run this race like Jesus did. Here's a couple of things. He says the key to running like Jesus did, as we pick up from verse 1, it talks about, the number one is, we need to throw off all the things that hinder, isn't that right? Throw off all the things that hinder and the sin that that so easily entangles. So what were we talking about here? If you really want to run in such a way as to really gain and finish well, it says anything that slows you down, you got to throw it off. You know, I know times that I've gone out, you know, running or, you know, it's like there's one day, you know, you're running. And then if you're running and it's raining, guess what happens? All the clothes you're wearing gets soaked and you're carrying baggage. And it's like the race, you know, something that would have taken you a few minutes. It's like, whoa, because you're carrying so much weight. It's saying those are the times where you just peel them off. And I ask myself, even as I'm reading this, I'm thinking, okay, what are the things that has hindered me this year? What are the things that are hindering me right now from really having the kind of connection I need to have with God? And I know, I don't know what it is for you, but God is saying, identify it and let's throw it off. Then you watch God do amazing things in your life. And some of us, it could be that Netflix that we've been watching, all those series. We sit there and we're watching all this program that, you know, it's like one moves and the another one comes in and it's like, they want to keep you on that couch, like a couch potato. But it says, you see, those things can actually stop you from taking out some time to engage with the Word of God that will fill you up with vision and power, and it will stop you from even engaging and going out to practice the ones you have learned. Because it could be Netflix. For some of us, it could be sports. And for those of us like me who have passed football playing days, we play the football on our couch, giving instruction to all the ones playing about how they're supposed to play. And this afternoon, England is going to be playing, and some of us will be coaching, you know, Southgate and everything, how he's doing. But, you know, it's like, hey, there's nothing wrong with watching football or watching any sports or participating in any sport. In fact, you should. But don't let it become a hindrance to the thing that really matters the most. And for many of our young people, it's like YouTube, watching those YouTube things. You know, some of you have your phone and watching, or TikTok or whatever you call it, or, you know, Twitter, and yeah, your fingers never stop moving, even as some of them were singing and they're going, you know. So, hey, listen, don't let those things take you off from actually engaging in a way. Throw them off. Get yourself absorbed in God. Are we together in that? Not everything that is permissible is actually profitable to you. Not everything that is legal, allowable, they're not beneficial to you. Let's home in on that. Are we together? Any sin that could trip you up, let's figure them out and start exposing them. And it's so important for us to really think clearly on those. Because those sins that we know, it's not like, you know, some of us think, oh, the big sin, oh, I am not smoking, I am not, you know, womanizing, I'm not adulterous or this. But hey, let's look at things like lukewarmness. Let's look at things like even impurities. But anyway, we'll cover all those. But you know what your own is. But in order to really be victorious, if you expose it, God cleans it off. That is the beauty that we have in Christ, that the blood that we were covered with at baptism remains with us. And if we sin, 1 John chapter 1, verse 8 to 10 tells you, if you sin, expose it. And the blood of Christ will continue purifying it. That is the beauty, that every day, you can actually be a new creation, free. Like some people say, free at last. But that's the first one. True of all hindrance and sin. The second thing, stay in the marked out lane. That is one that really, I had to read it again. Whoa. It says, you got to persevere and stay on your lane. You know, like in a race. All these races, like you, no matter how much you train, how good you are at running, if you step across from your lane into a different lane, what's going to happen to you? Disqualified. But how does that happen to us? You see, the Bible talks about the road to salvation. The road to having the fulfillment is a narrow road. But there is a wider road. God says, are you staying on the narrow road? It's like when you know the narrow road. Have you, how many of us have driven on a country lane in England? Man, it's incredible. It's, you don't know how small these roads are. I thought, yeah, roads in England, you know, it's all right, you know, dual carriageway. But when you travel out and see, you know, all these other places with six lanes, you're going, wow, I like to drive here. But when you're driving in those narrow lanes, you are paying attention. You know, sometimes, you know, it's like I use sat-nav, and then sat-nav, instead of taking me the proper road, it takes me, I want a shortcut, and then it takes me into some woods that I've never seen before. And guess what I have to do? I have to pay attention and stay on it, because if I deviate one way, I'm off. And I don't even know when I will find myself again. The same thing God is saying, that many of us want to find a relationship with God, but we don't bother following God's own instructions, the marked out way about how to get these things. We just follow what everybody says. I've fallen victim of that myself. You know, I grew up feeling, well, I was born in a Christian home, Christian, confirmed. In fact, I'm a Christian. And so I go to church, I do give my tithes, and, well, when I'm able to, you know. And then I was feeling I was a Christian. But did you know, I didn't even find that in the Bible. Where is the word Christian even in the Bible? But I'm a Christian. You see, there is a marked out road. And you see, I was thinking I was already on the road. And I was just copying what everybody else is doing. But the sad thing is, I would have died. And then face God, and it's like, I'm in the wrong house. Well, it's not the house I want to be. I want to be with God. But if you follow the wrong way, and I want to ask you today, are you checking the Bible how you came into Christ? Is it like the people in the Bible? Or are you just following the way that people have taught you or you have heard other people do? You see, I was so badly mistaken because, yeah, I felt I was already a Christian. And then, yeah, they told me to pray Jesus into my heart. I said, okay, sure, that's easy enough. Oh, tongue speaking, oh, yeah, teach me how to, and I'll teach other people too. But I read in the Bible, there's no one even coming into Christ by praying Jesus into their heart. But if that's what is taught, does that change what God's way is? And then I was struggling. Wow, if that's the case, man, that's serious. But you know, I thank God that some strangers that I met sat me down. And in fact, I thought I was teaching them because I knew a lot of the Bible. But they were actually practicing what they have read. Me, I read it and then I find my church to tell me how to do it their own way. But Jesus is saying here that in order to find, we don't only need to throw off everything that hinders, but we need to stay in the marked out way. There's a way that is marked out, and there's a way that is not. Even some of us as disciples, we are living the discipleship life our own way when it suits us. Here's an example of a couple of people that came to Jesus that Jesus had to actually try and get them to stay on the marked out road. In Luke chapter 9, verse 57 to 62, it's about three people. There was a friend I was sharing it with this week, so it was quite fresh on my mind. In 57, it says, as they were walking along the road, a man said to Jesus, him, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus replied, foxes have holes, or have dens, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. He said to another man, follow me. Oh, yeah, of course, I am ready, he replied. Lord, first, let me go and bury my father. Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Still another said to him, I will follow you, Lord, but first, let me go and go back and say goodbye to my family. Jesus replied, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. What are we talking about here? It's about three people who somehow haven't followed the marked out way. The first one, oh yeah, I want to be a Christian. I want to follow. Oh yeah, they will come to church. That could be you here today. But have you looked at what Jesus says it will take for you to be a disciple? It says would you obey when it's not comfortable? Like, you see, the birds of the air, they have their comfortable, you know, nest. They will go, you know, like, it's cold today. They will just be in the nest. And, ooh, yeah, having a nap. But, oh, and they say, oh, no, I don't want to go out today. Oh, no, I think. So God is saying, to follow in him, running like he run. When it's not comfortable, would you still obey? Because if you don't obey, you are going to be in trouble. I remember my second marathon that I ran. It was very cold in here in England. And then so I had a chance to go and preach in Ghana by then. And so during my training, I stopped my training because I went to Africa Men. Just to run 1 mile, I would carry frozen water. By the time I do 1 mile, the frozen water has turned to hot tea. And I couldn't run. And so it's like, wow, you know, I tried, but, you know, it's not really convenient. It's not working out in this Africa. I packed it. By the time I come back, I only have 2 weeks before the race. And I thought, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Let me tell you, I suffered in that marathon like no man's business. And after that, I said, I've finished with marathon running. But I'm still, I said, one more. But what am I saying that? It's just the fact that sometimes we only want it when it's comfortable. And then he says, the foxes have dens. You know, it's like if you meet a fox in your neighborhood, if you just shake like this, and they just go, boom, and you think, where is he? Because he has got little convenient routes that you don't even see. But if you try to chase them, they'll disappear. And 2 minutes later, he says the same way. We can be living our life, running our Christian life in a convenient way. Oh, if it works for me. Oh, if I feel good. Oh, yeah, well, that one doesn't work for me. Oh, this is not my style. We didn't become disciples to do our style. We did not become disciples to do it our way. We became disciples to deny ourselves because ourselves doesn't get the job done. We said we would deny ourselves. We will take up whatever pain it takes to really live the way and run the way Jesus will. So that is what we signed up for. But before we know it, we are running our own marked out race. No longer Jesus. Jesus says, let's get it together. He wants us to finish in a great style. Let's do it Jesus' way. Are we together in that? Okay. Then the third thing, he says, hey, you got to fix your eyes on Jesus. Throw off the thing. Basically, the second one is stay on the mark route. But then the third thing is fix your eyes on Jesus. It's all about focus. Stay focused on the finishing point. Don't get distracted. When I was running the marathon, you know, you see people, all the children are out there on the street encouraging you, giving you sweets. And then I was enjoying it and, you know, all these sweets. And before you know it, the sweet, I'm not used to eating it when I run. And then it turned my stomach into, it's like something else was happening to me. I wasn't thinking about the running. I'm running. My stomach is running, everything. I'm having headaches. And it's like if you get distracted from what you started. And in marathons, let me tell you that, there's something called the 17-mile to 18-mile. It's like a wall. You may enjoy it, but when you do 17-mile, get to that point, it's like all the whole energy is finished. The will, the only thing that carries you through that thing is just the will. You're like, why am I in this race? Because your body is not doing it anymore. Your leg says, I'm finished. So it's only the mind. But if you get distracted, yes, I did get, distracted, and I'm like, oh, goodness, I can't go anymore. I'm almost coughing blood. You know, it's like when you begin to think you're coughing blood, then it's like, and then the reality start coming, and then I say, okay, I need to go to the tent. I went to the tent. By the time they start massaging me, I was enjoying it so much. I said, no, I would not. If I stay like this, I'm not going to walk anymore. I finished here. I will lie in this bed. So I just had to run out from that tent and take off again. But hey, God is telling us the same thing. Don't stay focused. Don't get distracted. There's so many things that is distracting many of us. Even Christmas, as we celebrate Jesus is born, can become a distraction. we forget that we want to have a triumphant life, a life that shines. And then we start engaging ourselves in parties that we shouldn't go to, office parties that, oh yeah, you know, it's supposed I'm just going to be there, it's parties, mingling with people. But then we start doing and talking all kinds of things. Let's watch ourselves. Let's make Christmas a glorious one to the glory of God. Are we together in that? Let's watch each other. Let's support each other and really make it, keep our eyes focused on her. And the final thing it talks about from verse 3 to 12 is about enduring to the end, persevering and pushing through. It says Jesus is our model. He endured even the cross. Opposition from everyone. There was not anyone on his side. He has shown us how to be triumphant. He did not lose heart or grow weary, but he allowed his Holy Spirit to minister to him as he prayed and cried out to God that he could be able to stand up again and say, rise, let's go. God wants us to imitate him, to imitate his son in that way. We will be tempted. We may not feel we're able to do it, but nobody ever died for making, you know, enduring. Christ has said in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, no trials have you faced, that every trial is common to man. And God knows what he allowed to come your way. If it becomes too much, God himself will provide a way out. So it's a promise. There will be a way out. But the question is, will you take the way out? Sometimes we don't want the way out. We want God to change his own way, to come to our own way. So that is, after finish off our third point and the last point, we're just going to quickly read the passage and then summarize. Are we all together in that? So that's how to run with Jesus. Finally, you got to stay in the race to the very end. I will just read the passage because it speaks for itself. From verse 14, it says, make every effort to live in peace with everyone and be holy. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one falls short of the grace of God, and that no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defy many. See that no one is sexually immoral or is godless like Esau, who for a single meal sold his inheritance right as the oldest son. Afterwards, as you know, when he wanted to inherit this blessing, he was rejected. Even though he sought the blessing with tears, he could not change what he had done. What a tragedy. Verse 18, you have not come to a mountain that can be touched and that is burning with fire, to darkness, gloom, and storm, to a trumpet blast, or to such a voice speaking words that those who heard it begged that no further word be spoken to them, because they could not bear what was commanded. If even an animal touches the mountain, it must be stoned to death. The sight was so terrifying that Moses said, I am trembling with fear. That's not what we come for. 22. But you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem. You have come to thousands upon thousands of angels in joyful assembly, to the church of the firstborn, whose names are written in heaven. You have come to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of righteous made perfect, to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. See to it that you do not refuse him who speaks. If they did not escape when they refused him who warned them on earth, how much less will we if we turn away from him who warns us from heaven? At that time, his voice shook the earth, but now he has promised, once more, I will shake not only the earth, but also the heavens. The words, once more, indicating the removal of what can be shaken, that is, created things, so that what cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe. For God is a consuming fire. Wow! we've got to stay in the race till the very end. The key to staying in the race, it tells you, you live at peace with all others people and pursue holiness. That is verse 14. You see, living at peace with people is like the acid test whether you even have a relationship with God. 1 John chapter 1 tells us that some of us think that, I have a good relationship with God, but it's all these sinful men that are problems. The Bible tells us, no, if you are having issues upon issues with people, you can count it that you don't have one. Because heaven is going to be full of God's sinners that have been rescued. So if fellowship is a problem to you, man, heaven is going to be boring to you. You with me on that one? So whatever is hindering you from connecting with people, allow God's Holy Spirit to help you. But he says, live at peace with all people. It's the same thing Jesus explained in Matthew chapter 5, verse 8 to 9. He says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemaker, for they will be called children of God. Our relationship with others is truly the acid test. I had to ask, am I really a peacemaker, not a peacekeeper? See, many of us are just conflict avoiders. We rather than go make peace. You don't make peace by staying passive, do nothing. You see, things are not going well, even in your marriage, with your spouse, or with people, neighbors. You just stay passive and wait. Time will sort it out. Time never changes anything. God says, my children, you stay in the race by you initiating to make peace. Are we together in that? Do you win people over? Or do you say, we agree to disagree. Jesus don't do agree to disagree. Jesus, in humility, wins people over. Let's be people that deal with conflict by winning over, not proving our own points. Are we together in that? And then it talks about, pursue holiness. It's like, that's what that Matthew passage says. Those who are pure in heart are those who are going to see God. So how is my purity? How pure is my heart? How pure is my motivation? Let's be checking those things. Because it's not about what we do for God, but how pure are we fighting to keep our hearts so that the Holy Spirit can have the freedom to settle in our life and produce what it needs to produce. When we don't preserve purity in our heart, then we actually quenching the work of the Holy Spirit in our life. When you resist the Holy Spirit or grieve the Holy Spirit by creating a real mess that the Holy Spirit is not comfortable with, then how are we going to see transformation? But what a joy to see, yes, many of us are actually fighting, not only fighting for ourselves, but supporting one another. That's what God wants us to do. And I believe those are the things you were thinking, wow, why is God doing so much miracle and things like that? It's because we began to more fight with each other to really preserve a pure heart. You know, I had to ask as well, it's like, are there secret areas of my life that are not really exposed? People who live in secrecy, the Holy Spirit, the light, does not work in secrecy. We need to expose things so that God can clean it up and really operate in a powerful way. Second thing, live at peace. But then the next thing, it says, no bitter roots and don't miss grace. How are you doing with keeping, bitterness in your heart? Do you hold bad attitudes? Let's start, because these are the things. It says things that so easily entangles, they entangle the whole thing, and then God is not able to do all the miracles he wants to do in our life. It says no godlessness or sexual immorality. I had to ask, wow, for Esau, he said godless because he sold in his inheritance. It's like, how much am I selling God off for? If someone offers me, it's like the question I had to even or ask myself, and the thing is like, do I trade material gain for my relationship with God or in the body of Christ? You know, someone offers me something, material thing, and I'll be chasing that and forget about my time with God or my time with God's children or the very things that I have planned to do for God become secondary because I'm chasing some material gains. Judas, for 30 pieces of silver, sold Christ out. What is your own price tag? Let's ask ourselves. Finally, it says from that verse 18 to 29, it's all about embracing humility and gratitude because that is the only acceptable way to really worship God. Many of us, when we think about worshiping of God, we think singing. No. The Bible talks about, no, it's not really singing. Singing is overflow from a heart of humility, a heart that's filled with gratitude. Singing will burst out. But the singing, you can sing, but when you don't have gratitude, you're not really worshiping God. If you are singing, but you're not even humbling to realize who God is, there's no reverence for who God is, and you think you're the king of the world, it's like, it's not worshiping. So he says, hey, let's worship God with reverence and fear. But the contrast he gives them, you know, these Christians who are turning away, he gives them a picture of what happened during the old covenant being given to Moses. It was at a mountain that, I mean, all kinds of things was going haywire. Everybody's like, wow, they're praying to God, please don't even let us hear the voice anymore because there was so much fear and everything was like, whoa, God is showing them, you want power? Catch this. But he says, look at that contrast with the law being passed on to Moses and what we now have in Christ. I mean, it's like chalk and cheese. In Christ, you have come to a new plan, a new way to draw near to God. You have not come to all this crazy that God, you know, it's like sometimes we feel God is punishing me or God is, no. God is one actually rooting for us. You have come to the heavenly city. You have come to the kingdom of God. You have come to the church of the firstborn. This is even what is in the Old Testament. They are waiting till we have what we have right now. Because the blood is still what forgives Moses, what forgives Abraham. And Christ dying and producing the blood is what they needed. But it's what we've got. We are coming to an incredible kingdom of God. The family of believers, the community, the more we actually embrace it, the more it will work for us. God is saying, let's start being grateful for the kingdom that we have received. And let's humble ourselves because we have done it our own way before. It didn't work. That's why we packed up and came to Christ. But right now, let's humble ourselves again and be grateful. God can say no to our prayers. God can say not yet. God can say yes, but he's doing it all for our good. So, the race of life is here. How are we running it? God is calling us in this morning, this afternoon, that we should run it just like Christ. We should run it and stay in the race till the very end. May God bless you. Amen.
Well, thank you, Charles, for bringing us to the foot of this powerful message from Hebrews 12. And there's so many questions that you wrote out, but I just want to highlight a few. And I think even your illustration about running the marathon, now I haven't run the marathon, and based on what you've shared, I think is good advice that I don't. But the whole illustration, and I think the main thing was just about what are the things that hinder. And as you mentioned that you know, it might not even be the big things, it's a little thing sometimes, and I know that for myself, that's something that daily I have to always think. You start off your day with good intentions, you end up in somewhere else, and you find out that you're being distracted. And one of the things that you mentioned is that, you know, what is it that's absorbing you? Get absorbed with things of God. And also you mentioned not everything that is legal is useful. And I think that's the challenge, is that these are things that they're not necessarily bad, but then we have to use wisdom and discernment to say, okay, is this actually helping me grow closer to God? And then other things that you mentioned about when it is comfortable, when it's not comfortable, will I still obey? Things like that. These are decisions that I know I need to wrestle with myself, but all of us do, you know. And even if you're watching this as well, these are the questions that we all need to take away. There are many other things, but let's continue this conversation in the fellowship in terms of decisions that we are going to make. But thank you, Charles, for today's message. Thank you very much. I'm going to hand over to NEA just to pray.
Amen. Let's pray about what we've heard today. Dear God, Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, Father, for this day. Though it may be cold, but Father, we thank you for the power of your word, God, that really warms up our hearts, Father, and calls us back, Father, to fix our eyes on you. Father, we thank you for today's service and all of the various aspects of it that have helped us to just turn our attention back to you and to reset, Father, for the week ahead. We thank you for this month of December and just guiding us throughout this year and bringing us to this point. We thank you for the worship today and the words that we've sung, Father. We thank you for our digital team and just all the work that goes on behind the scenes. We thank you for the leadership team, Away Day, God, and the plans that you are putting on their hearts, God, and for us, Father, to be our best for you, God, in the coming year. Father, we thank you for the decision that Tony and Yah have made today to recommit and rededicate their lives to you, Father. We're grateful for all that you're doing in our midst. Father, we thank you for the sermon that we've heard today. Thank you for using Charles to remind us of your truth, Father, for using him to speak as one speaking the very words of God. We pray, Father, that through the message today, that we can choose a life of eternity with you. And that, Lord, we can be convinced that no other life is more attractive, God. We pray that we can persevere. We know, Father, that there are hardships on this side, God, living on earth. We know that, you know, there's so much, God. We're living in a time of great inflation and cost of living crisis and, you know, just wars in the world and just so much going on. But we pray, Father, that our eyes will be fixed on you, that you give us a greater spirit of endurance and perseverance, God, and resilience to run this race that you have marked out for us. Help us to do away with anything that hinders us, God, from living the faith life. Give us the strength through the power of your Holy Spirit, God, to allow Jesus to be supreme to all else in our lives, Father. Help us to not be distracted like what we've heard, God. Help us to daily live intentionally for you. May we grow to appreciate your discipline in our lives, God. May we grow to see it from the right perspective, God, and to not despise it at all, knowing that it is our salvation. Help us to be encouraged by you and by each other, God, and by living a godly life, God, unshackled by sin. Help us to throw off, God, that which hinders us. Help us to live a life that is mixed with reverent fear, God, and joy by being in you, Lord. Help us to live a life of self-denial and to stay holy, God, to not allow bitterness to take root in our hearts, God, to live in harmony, to appreciate all that you have done, God, and to stay, God, in the lane that you have marked out for each and every one of us, God, to be sure of what our calling is and to live out your purpose and to follow your instructions from your word. Father, we know that we cannot do this apart from you. We ask that your Holy Spirit empowers us to live with pure hearts, God, and unblemished motivations. Father, thank you so much for all that you do. May we embrace a life of humility and gratitude, as acceptable worship to you, God. And may we stay on this race and not deviate to the right or to the left, but to stay on that straight and narrow path that you have carved out for us. Lord, we thank you so much for your grace, your love, and your mercy. We pray all of this and more in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, so before our final song, just a few announcements. First of all, parents, please be picking up your children at 12:45. And also, as it's been mentioned, the exciting news of the baptism of Yah and Tony, that will take place shortly after the service. There's also a leaders' meeting at 1:15 or around that time. And if your heart has been stirred and you want to grow in your relationship with God, please reach out to the person that either invited you, or if you're watching this online and you want to connect with us, there will be handles that will be shown at the end of this if you can connect with us on that. Right now, we're going to stand up and have our final song. Thank you. Anyway.
Okay, thank you, Charles, for the message. As we consider our response to it, let us appropriately sing, Lord, Reign in Me.
Over all the earth, you reign on high. Every mountain stream, every sunset sky. Lord, my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again? All the earth, you reign on high. Every mountain stream, every sunset sky. Lord, my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again. Over every thought, over every word, may my life reflect the beauty of my Lord. You mean more to me than any earthly thing. So won't you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again. So won't you reign in me again. So won't you reign in me again.
Man, let's have a great time of fellowship.